Hey, I'm Jonathan, and this is rad-head. Today I'm gonna dive into the physics of this spinning water tank and calculate the exact curve of the water surface. If you have some basic high school physics background, I urge you to pause the video now and try finding the curve yourself. Otherwise, let's get started. In this classic demonstration, we can see the effect of the centrifugal force on the water level in our tank. While this demonstration is nice to play with as is, let's get a slightly deeper understanding of it by finding the curve that the water is creating. Apparently, this is a fairly easy task to do. We're gonna be looking at this frame for a while, so let's clean these little water droplets. Let's start by defining our coordinate system, so the y-axis is aligned with the axis of rotation. Now, let's examine what happens to a single water droplet right on the surface. It must be in equilibrium. Otherwise, it would roll down due to gravity or roll up due to the centrifugal force. Let's examine all the forces acting on this droplet. We have the gravitational force pointing down. This force is equal to the mass of the droplet times the gravitational acceleration. The centrifugal force is pointing away from the rotation axis. Its magnitude depends on the angular speed of the tank omega and the distance from the rotation axis, which is simply the x coordinate of the droplet. The exact term is m omega squared x. And lastly, we have the normal force, which is exactly perpendicular to the surface the droplet is resting on. Yes, this droplet is resting, which means that all these forces have to cancel each other out. We want to split the normal force into two components that are in the directions of the gravitational and the centrifugal force. This process depends on the angle of the normal force. Let's mark it with alpha. We can notice that this angle is equal to the angle between the tangent at this point and the x-axis. This angle represents the slope of the curve. Actually, it's the tangent of this angle that is defining the curve derivative at this point. Let's keep that in mind. After splitting the normal force to its components, we demand that the forces will cancel each other out, both in the x and the y directions. This gives us two equations. Dividing them gives us an expression for tangent alpha, which we can just substitute with the derivative of the curve. This is not a standard equation. We don't have a relation between y and x. We have a relation between the derivative of y and x. What we have here is probably the simplest form of a differential equation. The way to solve this equation is to integrate both sides to get an expression for y. This, of course, is a parabola. C is some constant that does not depend on x, but could be dependent on any of the other variables in this system. It simply determines the vertical positioning of the parabola. To find it, we'll use the fact that the amount of water in the tank does not change. So if we'll draw the x-axis where the water level is at rest, then, when spun, the sides rise above the x-axis and the center drops below it. Because the amount of water hasn't changed, and in this case the water are basically incompressible, the area that rose above the x-axis should be exactly the same as the area of the void in the center. To put this in the form of an equation, we simply ask that the definite integral over our curve should be zero. That is because areas below the x-axis count as negative areas, thus should cancel out the areas above. The integral is again a very simple one, and after some algebra, we can isolate C to get the complete equation of our curve. Now let's put this equation to the test. Let's try and find out how fast I made the water tank spin. Of course, we can just take the slow-mo footage and count the frames it took to complete a full revolution. But where's the fun in that? Let's choose the frame in which the water is furthest apart and try to fit a simple parabola of the form y equals ax squared plus b. I do this by choosing a few points on the surface of the water and doing a simple least square fit. Now I can take either of the coefficients from the obtained parabola and simply compare it to the corresponding coefficient of the theoretical parabola, the one we've just derived. In this case, I'm using the quadratic part. I can then extract omega from the equation, which is measured in radians per second. Converting units to RPM, we get 291 revolutions per minute. Pretty fast, I'd say. Calculating the actual RPM by counting the amount of frames it took to complete a full revolution, we get 290 revolutions per minute, which given our very crude methods is basically the same number. I made two more water tanks to spin. The first is a cylindrical vessel that very clearly shows the full 3D paraboloid created on the surface of the water. The second tank is a cube, which I think is the most satisfying one to watch. It shows the same paraboloid, but there is something in the way the water in the corners raises above the water near the sides that gives it its very unique and pleasing look. Just to recap what we did in this video, we started by observing a physical phenomenon, then formulating a mathematical representation of this observation using simple physics and math. And finally, we've put our analysis to the test. By using it to measure a value, we could easily verify by a direct measurement. This is what science is all about. Almost. If you're interested in seeing how I made this demonstration, check out the build video I made. I also have some more detailed plans on my website, if you wish to build one for yourself. And if you enjoy watching these sort of videos, please consider supporting this channel by becoming a patron. Until next time, bye.